Nowadays, most of what I do is rail against individual scenarios. Effectively, my main content has become vocal disagreement with the current state of AAA gaming. There are certainly other topics interspersed throughout that pattern, but in large part, the content focuses on pro-consumer advocacy in the face of corporate profiteering. Business is booming, by the way. There is no shortage of material, and I struggle to picture there being one anytime soon. So today, rather than focusing on an individual display, I would like to examine the fall of AAA gaming, and the road by which we reached this current industry reality. Late-stage capitalism is a term thrown around a lot these days. The phrase is rooted in Marxist ideology, and while I disagree with certain aspects of that belief system, there are merits to the description of what late-stage capitalism is when we apply it to the games industry in particular. Loosely defined, the term in its current social media usage describes failings within the capitalistic economy of the United States that lead to disproportionate wealth distribution. Basically, it means the system has progressed to a point where wealth and control has solidified to a small percentage of the population, and this condensation of resources is a natural intrinsic effect of capitalism, which only increases further over time. In some ways, this makes a lot of sense, in others, it doesn't. There are arguments to be made for and against the claim, but for today's application, we need to adjust the format partially to redirect it towards gaming. Late-stage capitalism can also refer to the imperative for profit. This may seem like a given, but in a capitalist system, profit is the primary motivation, and there is an added layer that most of the major game publishers adhere to in the form of shareholder expectations. The format is simple. Make more money than you did last quarter or the previous year. Do this consistently and forever, because there is no recognized ceiling. This is not just a loose set of guidelines. This is the holy grail of capitalism in a free market investor system. Earn more because you can earn more. Executives are often replaced, fired, or removed entirely because they fail during the pursuit of this prime directive. And there are certainly exceptions to this widespread standard, companies and leadership that preserve some of the fundamental integrities that are required for good business, but the exceptions make the rule, and the vast majority of gaming publishers, at least the ones responsible for what we now accept as the AAA market, by and large, operate under the traditional format of quarterly and yearly increases above all things. This is where I have to devolve into a pretty lengthy metaphor, and honestly, a great many viewers will probably already have a full understanding of the terminology and its application to the gaming industry, but for those that do not, picture this. You decide to have a lemonade stand. You buy lemons, cups, and set up a booth. The customers roll in, the profit begins to flow, and it's a modest amount, but you find success. The season concludes, you pack up the booth, and enjoy the rewards. All in all, success, but the journey has just begun. Next year, summer comes around and it's time for the stand, but this time you need to make more money. Well, it turns out that earning more isn't hard this year. Word of mouth has begun to spread awareness of your product, more customers, more profit, another successful year. This is called natural growth, and thankfully, organically, it carries you a few more seasons as you reach more and more potential customers. However, the climbing standard of profit stops for no man. Eventually, the natural growth levels off as you tap into the entirety of your immediately accessible market, and the expansion stagnates. Now it is time to innovate. As a first step, you onboard public investment money to open more locations. You start finding new lemonade flavors, putting some money into advertising, expanding the booth, keeping it open longer, and starting earlier. And for years and years, you maintain the growth that is expected. But over time, the necessity for innovation becomes more and more demanding. As you near the peak of your total accessible market, advertising yields diminishing returns. People begin to lose interest in your best-selling flavors, but this plateau is unacceptable. To maintain seasonal increases, you need to cut back on costs. You begin to cut the lemonade with water, add cheaper sugars, push out new flavors before they are actually ready to ensure that the yearly report has high enough numbers. The marketing begins to lose its authenticity. Customer trust deteriorates, and your reputation begins to slide. This is where the breakdown truly begins to escalate. As customer faith plummets, you begin to lace the lemonade with nicotine or other addictive substances. You may lose some customers as health advocacy groups take aim at you, but the ones that get hooked will spend far more, and temporarily they provide the profit increase that you need to keep your job, as your now publicly traded lemonade stand answers to the beck and call of millionaire and billionaire investors who have literal, tangible control over who leads the enterprise. What began as a simple lemonade stand has turned into a soulless, gluttonous corporation that must increase its bottom line even when the only way to do so is to consume its own user base as a disposable commodity rather than a respected benefactor. This is the scenario we are in with AAA gaming. This should not be construed as a claim that the industry is completely void of talent, passion, and creativity. A huge number of developers labor under various projects because they truly care about the craft. But the creatives on the ground are not in control of the development direction and monetization of these games. Here's an example. The exclusivity agreement that pioneered the new age of Epic Games and its rock-bottom user reputation was kicked off by Metro Exodus and their acquisition of that title. The game itself is quite fun, and I enjoyed it a large amount. However, the creative personnel that are responsible had absolutely no control over the negotiation to pursue an exclusive agreement. That decision was made at a higher level by the publisher, Deep Silver, a subsidiary of Koch Media. Similarly, the decision to move Borderlands 3 to the Epic Store for a period of 6 months was made by Take-Two Interactive, the controlling interest behind Gearbox as a developer. And there are a host of separate issues and controversies with that title in particular, but the example maintains itself as a showcase of how the creative teams that physically produce the games that we all know and love have little or no control over the rest of the process. Developers who specialize in world design, concept art, or modeling, just to name a few examples there, are not the ones making the decisions to include loot box gambling. The lemonade stand analogy may have left a few viewers with the impression of hyperbole, but gambling is addictive. It is an escalation on the concept of microtransactions, which is an escalation on the concept of DLC, which is a regression, often, on the idea of a fully released product, and the trend is undeniable. The AAA games industry is emblematic of late-stage capitalism, a phrase that typically seems to express distaste at the absurdities and indignities of our modern economic climate, can be perfectly adapted to represent the evolution of video game production over the past few decades. All this merely speaks to the infrastructure of what the industry has become, and leaves out the secondary factors which are equally as important. Creative stagnation has become rampant in the annualized franchises, and when annualized franchises compose a massive section of the AAA market as a whole, this only serves to accelerate the decline when it can no longer be staved off with alternative methods. We've seen in the past year or so some extreme volatility in the gaming company share prices, and since stability of growth is such a high priority, reliance on proven methods to automate a publisher's profit cycle has become increasingly common. If one game successfully utilized open-world RPG storytelling, as an example, many more begin to do so as well. The concept of Battle Royale is a perfect example of this. The mode's ascent to popularity was rapid and complete, but the utilization is now almost entirely predictable. Another recent example, in my eyes at least, is Ghost Recon Breakpoint. The game feels like a mashup of proven concepts from Ubisoft's other titles, which projects an atmosphere of extreme risk aversion, in an industry where, at least on a AAA level, less and less risks are even being taken. When audience saturation has largely been reached, the subsequent evolution seems to be a reliance on having customers pay more for less with increasing frequency. There are certainly attempts at innovation and dramatic risks taken. It does happen. An example would be Death Stranding, which has been projected by Hideo Kojima as a proposed new genre entirely, but with such an overwhelming majority of titles either fully annualized or franchised into routine iterative releases with relatively low levels of modification, how long is it before the buying audience loses not only their interest in the brand name, but also their flat-out ability to afford the parceled-out, chopped-up format with pre-order bundles, DLC, season passes, microtransactions, and whatever else is in the pipeline. The fall of AAA gaming has been slow, driven by the underlying expectation that improving beyond what is comfortably possible must become normal and steady. It may seem counterintuitive to claim that the industry has fallen while we receive more games than ever with incremental graphical improvements and other advances from a variety of industry leaders, but when there is an inability and unwillingness to recognize the existence of an upper limit, it creates a singular inevitability. When that upper limit is hit, and it will be reached, by the way, there will be catastrophe. We are seeing the ramifications begin to manifest in the form of conflict with sovereign government regulation, critical mass when it comes to consumer goodwill and brand faith, plus a myriad of other consequences that are directly related to the expectation of infinite growth in a finite space. And that's really one of the best ways to sum it all up. Infinite growth is expected in a finite space, and it really cannot happen. I largely disagree with the current mainstream definition of late-stage capitalism, at least from a millennial perspective, like all the kids on social media and the way that they use it, but when applied to the games industry in particular, it holds a tremendous amount of truth. The question is not if the AAA market will radically change under the pressure, the question is when will it happen. I could never propose an exact date, but I would speculate that the day is coming sooner rather than later, since there is a cumulative effect to this progression. There isn't a whole lot that can be done from a consumer perspective to remedy all this either. I get asked pretty often, what should we do? And there are half measures that can be taken, but none of them address the root cause. And we really, honestly can't address the root cause as consumers. It may sound pessimistic, but my honest opinion is that being well informed of industry expectations and making a conscious effort to explore indie titles while rewarding up-and-coming talent is one of the only ways to fully prepare, and no matter what, change is coming. That's it for today. If you want to support, there are links down below, particularly the Twitter page. I'm looking to accurately grow that to a reasonable size when compared to the YouTube channel, which so far has not really happened. So if you have any interest in mediocre tweets at best, go ahead and follow there. I'll try not to false advertise and say that they're going to be the most epic tweets you've ever seen, because that's definitely not true. Plus, there's Patreon and whatever else, but I'll cut it there and stop rambling. As always, thank you all for watching, and have a nice night.